And God spake all this word, saying, I am the Lord thy God, which have brought thee out of the land of Egypt, out of the house of bondage. Thou shalt have no other gods before me. Thou shalt not make unto thee any graven image or any likeness of anything that is in heaven above, or all that is in the earth beneath, or that in the water under the earth. Thou shalt not bow unto thyself unto them, nor serve them. For I, the Lord thy God, I am a jealous God, visiting iniquity of fathers upon the children and upon third and fourth generation of them that hate me, and showing mercy unto thousands of them that love me and keep my commandments. Thou shalt not take the name of the Lord thy God in vain, for the Lord will not hold him guiltless that take his name in vain. Shall we come to him in prayer again? Oh, dear Heavenly Father, this is your word that you reveal to us, O Lord. So we pray, O Savior, that you may speak to us through your word, O Savior. O Lord, may you glorify yourself, even the preaching of your word. In the name of the Lord Jesus, we pray. Amen. As we come to this book, we are seeing very well, it is a revelation of God. God inspiring the writers of the Bible. Moses is inspired by the Holy Spirit as God gave them this commandment. God came to them as people whom he have redeemed from the power of Egyptian captivity. He has been a merciful God to them. So their cry and their suffering in Egypt, and so God has come to deliver them. What amazing God he is. He rescued them from the bondage. They were in bondage, and the mighty one of Israel came and delivered them. And so that's the beginning where we see the commandment. And you know, we are seeing this is inspired word of God, and so it is authoritative. It has got authority over us, and we have to embrace it as the very word of God, which God has revealed to us in the Holy Scriptures. Ten Commandments are beneficial. Number one, they reveal the will of God. The Ten Commandments, as we read, they reveal to us God's will. And so even still now, the commandments reveal to us God's will. And so we must take it seriously. Can you imagine? The Lord has rescued the children of Israel from Egyptian captivity. And he gave them his word. They needed the word. They needed the commandment. You know, miracles, people forget easily. They go. What was it that was going to sustain them on their way as they walk along? It was God's word. God gave them this commandment and they revealed his will. And also, Ten Commandments, they were pointing to Christ. They were pointing to Christ. When you read the Ten Commandments, you just see that we cannot keep them. You just see how fallen we are and how weak we are. And that leads us to the Lord Jesus Christ, who fulfilled all those commandments and he break none of them. He fulfilled all of them on our behalf. Even the one we are going to deal with, thou shalt not call the name of your God, the Lord your God, in vain. The Lord Jesus Christ, at the end of it, he said, I have glorified thy name in the world. So he glorified the name of God. And you know, when we are talking of the name of God, we are talking about his very character. So as you read the law, you just see how horrible we are and how weak we are and how we have broken every barrier down. At that point, ask to the Lord Jesus Christ that we need Christ. We need the Messiah. We need the one who is our own righteousness. The one who is our own sanctification. The one that we must depend on. And this law is still binding, especially to believers. Believers are not saved by observing the law, but believers delight in the law of God. They have been redeemed. They don't say, "Oh God, why did you say that I did not call your name in vain? Oh, why this body?" No, a believer is now redeemed, and a believer now delights in the law of God. The Puritans used to say this: when you read the law, when you read this commandment, Ten Commandments, you see how bankrupt you are and how dead you are in your sin. And as you see that bankruptness, it leads you to the Lord Jesus Christ. You run to Jesus Christ for mercy. You flee to the Lord Jesus Christ for mercy and hang upon him alone for mercy and for salvation and for grace. And when you go to the Lord Jesus Christ, and when he has rescued you and he has saved you, he now sends you back to the Lord to learn how to live. Amazing God who has revealed himself to us through his word. And so we come to that verse 20. And look at verse 7. Thou shalt not take the name of the Lord thy God in vain, for the Lord will hold him, will not hold him guiltless that take his name in vain. Look at that. He's saying that we should not take the name of God in vain. He's not saying that we should not call upon the name of the Lord. We are to call upon the name of the Lord. But his warning, I'll show you, maybe I'll read for you some few scriptures, how people call him, but not in vain. But he said, we should not call the name of God in vain. You know, when we are talking about the name of God, we are talking about God himself. We are talking about his nature. We are talking about his character. We are talking about his essence, God. When he appeared to Moses and said, "I am whom I am," he trembled. He trembled. And so when he's talking about calling the name, can you see even those name of God, they are used there in that particular verse. Thou shalt not take the name of the Lord. That's Yahweh. That's Yahweh, the great I am. The covenant-keeping God, the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. So it is Yahweh. The name that was revered and respected even by the Jews then. So he revealed himself as Yahweh. And then he said, the Lord your God, El. El. So God, who is almighty, who is powerful, who is great, you should not take his name in vain. What is it that is prohibited in this commandment? What is it that is prohibited in this commandment? I'll say this: all profaning of the name of the Lord God, all, everything that profane the name of God is not permitted here. Anything that profane his titles or his attributes. Sometimes in words, sometimes not even uttering it, sometimes in thoughts, sometimes in our hypocrisy. You come here and stand, praise the Lord again. I am saved and you are not saved. You are taking the name of the Lord in vain. So anything that go against his very nature, in our thoughts, and we take God very lightly, like one of us, not knowing that our God is transcendent and exalted above everything else. He's the creator, he's the maker, he's separate. And we take his name in vain. So that's what I'm going to, that's what number one thing which I'm saying, this commandment prohibit all things that profane the name of God, whether it is his titles, whether it is his attributes or character. This commandment say we should not do that. So again, you see, he's sending us to the Lord Jesus Christ. When you think of this, it takes us to the Lord Jesus Christ, and it makes us to also to be serious when we are thinking about God and when we are talking about God. How do we misuse the name of the Lord? So, by words which we utter, by words which we say concerning him. Those careless words that we utter. Sometimes by careless talking. Careless talking about God. Sometimes even wrong pronouncement. We pronounce the name of God wrongly, like G. Like G instead of God. Like Jah instead of Yahweh. So sometimes we take in the name of God in vain by pronouncing his name wrongly. And our generation is full of this. You hear them in your singing, you are singing today. JC Anabamba. JC Anabamba. So it just become like anyone. It just become like one of us. And that's using his name in vain. So sometimes we use the name of God in vain by the way we even talk about him. There's one song which was sometimes back I rejected when I heard it, Baba Godo, 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 Godo. He becomes so small that you can just call him the way you want, not the way he has revealed himself in the scriptures. And he wants us to call him in the scriptures. It is mentioning the name of God in vain. Another area where we mention the name of God is in vain is by swearing, using the name of God. Carelessly, not thoughtfully, we just swear. There are people who love to swear and to call the name of God in vain. And you know, sir, maybe you are guilty of it. Especially those of you who don't know Kikuyu. I think if there's a language that people have used to call the name of God or swear easily, is it in Kikuyu? Here in Kenya? You talk with your friend how the dance was good, and you hear them say, "Gai, gai, gai, gai." He's calling the name of God in vain. And sometimes by swearing, we swear carelessly. And by doing so, we are breaking this commandment. Dear friends, are we calling the name of God in vain? Are we calling the name of God in vain, maybe by repetition or in our singing? Do you remember that song which we say, Yahweh, Yahweh, Yahweh? And we repeat every day, can you do that with your father? Can you do that for your mother? Can you do that to the president? Calling the name of the Lord in vain. Sometimes even in prayer. Sometimes even in prayer. We can pray and we are not conscious. We are not thinking. By the way, sometimes even by greeting. You just meet a person like I was at the gate. The askari there met me and greeted me. Praise the Lord. It's just maybe you may be thinking of something else. You are not consciously praising the Lord. And in vain, you just take that as a greeting, as a form of greeting. You say, Nabwana asifiwe. Sometimes you remember we use it as a comma, punctuation, in our talks. I was invited in Jomo Kenyatta University by, I've forgotten your name, Nairobi Evangelistic Team. And then, Bwana asifiwe. The letter was long, Bwana asifiwe. And we use the name of God in vain, just like punctuation, where you stop and then do other thing. No, we should ponder deeply and think deeply about His holy name. And so that's what that commandment requires. How do we blaspheme the name of God? Sometimes by our actions and attitude. By our action and attitude. Let me just read to you this. Matthew chapter 7. Verse 22 and 23. Many will say to me in that day, Lord, Lord, have we not prophesied in thy name? And in thy name have cast out devils, and in thy name done many wonders. And then I'll profess unto them, I never knew you, depart from me, you workers of iniquity. So, calling the name of the Lord even here, they were prophesying, they were doing wonders, and with all these gifts, but were all in vain. The Lord tells them, I never knew you, you workers of iniquities. So it is possible that the very actions we do, we are blaspheming the name of the Lord. So we need even to have the right attitude. And we need to check our attitude as we think of these commandments. Let us read another one. Luke. Luke chapter 6. Verse 46. And why call ye me Lord, Lord, and do not do the things which I say? So we are living contrary to that which the Lord has revealed to us. And we still go ahead calling him Lord, Lord, Lord. And by doing so, we are calling the name of the Lord in vain. What does this commandment require then? What is the requirement of this command? This command that thou shalt not call the name of the Lord thy God in vain require that we glorify God, and we glorify God in our talks and in our prayers, like the Lord Jesus Christ taught us in Matthew chapter 6. When you pray, say, "Our Father who is in heaven, hallowed be thy name." And it's glorifying God. And the focus is upon God's glory, God's order, and reputation of his great name. And so you know here what he's saying. We say our Father. Why do we say, Christian, why do we say our Father? Because we have been adopted into the family of God by grace. God has adopted us into his family through the shed blood of the Lord Jesus Christ, his dear son. Through the death of the Lord Jesus Christ on Calvary cross, God is our Father. And now we can go to him and call him, "Our Father who is in heaven, hallowed be thy name." And you see, say, "Thy kingdom come." And then he's still lost, even he has not even come to his knee. "Thy will be done in heaven as it is on earth as it is in heaven." It is when now he comes to the knee. And so it's a name that we need to be revering or respecting or honoring the name of our God. It's honoring God himself. Because his name reveals who he is to us. So you are called upon, you young people, that is calling us to be able to glorify the name of God. Let us read Genesis chapter 18. Genesis chapter 18. Look at Abraham when he goes to the Lord, and this is how to glorify God. Look how he speaks about God here. Let me just begin verse 26, because it's about Sodom and Gomorrah. The destruction of Sodom and Gomorrah. So let's just maybe begin from that verse 26. And the Lord said, "If I find in Sodom 50 righteous within the city, then I'll spare all the place for their sake." And Abraham answered and said, "Behold, now I have taken upon me to speak unto the Lord. Which am I but a dust and ashes?" That's the reverence. That's how you ought to be calling upon the name of the Lord. "I am dust and ashes." In the New Testament, Paul will say, "I am what I am by the grace of God." And Abraham going before God, he said, "I am ashes speaking to you. Who am I even to talk to you? I'm just ashes. I'm nothing in thy sight." And that's the attitude that we need to have over and over again. Again, if you can look at verse 32. Exodus 32. Just some few examples. That's the Lord speaking. Now, therefore, let me alone, that my wrath may wax hot against them, and that I may consume them, and make thee of thee a great nation. So it's this God that we worship. He's a consuming fire. We don't need to joke with him. We need to respect him. We need to go in his presence with thanksgiving and gratitude in our hearts and with all humility. How I pray that this generation is a generation that have got all humility. We live at a time that people no longer respect even other people, even the fellow human beings. Today I was just talking to a man who wrote something about the president, you know, in politics. And I told him, where you are going, it's wrong. There's a way we need to address the president. It's a way we need to address those who are in authority. And we need to give them some respect and the dignity. And we have got a society that even God, we bring God to our level. But I'm appealing to you, you young people, that we need to bring glory to God. Let us look at Exodus 15, verse 11. Exodus 15, 11. Says, who is like unto thee, O God, Lord among the gods? Who is like unto thee, glorious in holiness, fearful in praise, doing wonders? That's the God we have in the Bible. And look at the attitude. Who is like God unto thee? You are incomparable, O God. And there is a God who works wonders. It's a God who is so glorious and so fearful, even when you come to him in the praise. So I'm appealing to you in the name of the Lord. I'm beseeching you in the name of the Lord that we need not to be calling the name of God in vain. And we are doing it, especially in your generation. Especially in your generation, people have got no reverence at all. Sometimes even very good songs, but the tone is bad. A very good song, but the tone lack reverence. That this song which we sing is one of those prayer for him. It goes like this. O sini pite mokozi. So the tone book. O sini pite mokozi. So it's a prayer for one. So the hymn writer came up with that tone, which is so prayerful. But you can have a tone that even that right song no longer have a reverence and respect for God. Usini pite, baba, unaponjo ingine, usini pite. So the reverence that is supposed to be there is no longer there. Or usini pite mokozi, usini pite baba. You know, you are the one who want to feel good, you know, and the reverence and the respect that it deserves is not there. Oh, may the Lord help us that when we are calling the name of the Lord, we are not calling his name in vain. Ways which we can fulfill this commandment. Ways which we can fulfill this commandment. Sorry, I'm rushing here and there because I know your time is also up. So ways we can fulfill this commandment. Number one, by believing in the Lord Jesus Christ. It is by trusting upon the Lord Jesus Christ, as I told you at the beginning. The Lord Jesus Christ, who alone have glorified the Father, honored his name in his fullness. And when we trust upon him and his righteousness is granted to us, then we are able to fulfill this. We are able to say, like Paul, I have been crucified with Christ. I no longer live. The life I live now, it is by faith in the Son of God who loved me and who gave himself for me. I have been crucified with Christ. It is coming to the Lord Jesus Christ. If you are not here and you are not born again, you are calling the name of God even now in vain. And I'm appealing to you, may you come to him through the Lord Jesus Christ. And you can cry like Apostle Paul that a great change has come into my life through the Lord Jesus Christ. He has transformed me. He has changed me. And now I am able to glorify God. And he, the Holy Spirit of God, will dwell in us. And he, the Holy Spirit of God, will help you. That your desire is to bring glory to the name of our Heavenly Father. And consciously worship him in the spirit and in truth. And with the sincerity of heart, you come to him. So the only way it is our trust upon the Lord Jesus Christ. Out of the Lord Jesus Christ, we cannot fulfill it. We cannot attain it. In fact, daily we are calling his name in vain. And I'm appealing it to you by the mercies of God, those of you who have not come in faith, to come in faith in him and put your trust upon our beloved Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. And those of us who are saved, may we trust and keep on clinging upon our beloved Lord and Savior. It is through him alone that we are able to glorify God by not calling his name in vain. Don't you see, when we come to the Father, we say, Father, in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, on his merit, on what he has secured on our behalf, we come. I think Fanny Crosby wrote a hymn and say, only through thy merit would I seek thy face. Leaning there in deep contrition, help my unbelief. It is only through the merit of the Lord Jesus Christ that we are able, dear brethren, to fulfill this. Also, outside Christ, it is impossible. It is impossible because we are fallen. But thank God for our beloved Lord and Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ. Also again, Paul said, I have been crucified with Christ. I no longer live, but the other one used to say, God forbid that I should glory in anything else except the cross of Christ Jesus, Christ our Lord, through which the world has been crucified to me and I to the world. It's only the cross that is able to nail the world to us, and our eyes can see properly, and we can glorify God and honor his name and speak his name not in vain. It's only through the Lord Jesus Christ. And I'm urging you in the name of the Lord, in order to fulfill this commandment, we need our Savior. And we need a constant reliance upon the Lord Jesus Christ and for his mercies. Another thing that we can help us to fulfill this commandment, it is by being honest and holy living. And again, this one left to ourselves, we are not able to do. And you know, he, the Holy Spirit, do help us. Living a life that is honest and holy, not like hypocrites who call him Lord, Lord, Lord. They are so vigorous that they don't call him once. They call him Lord, Lord, and they are not going. And when you look at their emotion, they are Lord, but they are not going. But living an honest and holy living. Offer your bodies, Romans chapter 12, offer your body now, because you have got this great truth which he has taught from chapter 1 to chapter 11. Now that you have got all these great doctrines and great truth that you have been justified by faith apart from your work, you can now offer your bodies as a sacrifice, holy and acceptable before God. Now we are able to offer our bodies. So by striving to be holy and being open and honest before our Savior and our God. Another way that we can now fulfill this commandment is by speaking to God in our prayers with reverence and with all respect. We go to Him in prayer. Instead of just calling His name, we go to Him in prayer. We bow before Him. We bow before Him because He's the King of Kings and He's Lord of Lords. So we bow before our God. Reverence has been lacking sometimes in our worship. The reverence knowing that we are before King of Kings and Lord of Lords. And we come there with all humility. Sometimes when we rush. Though I remember those days that people will come in the church, the Bible is being read, and people stand outside. They wait for the scriptures to be read. And sincerely waiting for the scriptures to be read. And when it's read, I'll say amen, and then they come in. Oh, somebody's praying. At the time of prayer, people are bound before God. They don't even want to cause any disturbance. People stay outside if they were late. They wait for a moment and then they come in. How we need to go to the Lord and bow in sincere prayer. We say, you are the Creator. We are your creatures. You are independent. We are dependent. We rely upon you. You are highly exalted with all exaltation. And we become before Him who lives forever and ever. And we talk to Him. And we say, Father, we come. Father, we come. We come. We come. Recently, I was telling people in church, I'm one of those people who sometimes talk quickly. But I'm telling them, you know, even sometimes when we are before God in prayer, we want even others to hear your prayers, like our brother was leading us here. And so you need those voices. You need to ponder, come to Him in prayer with reverence and respect.
Oh, not coming the way sometimes I used to.
No.
Some years back I used to.
Then you kick here. And you go here and you go there, you know. And it's all chaos.
I remember I went to a church that was praying quietly. And I said, these people have got no spirit here. We took over with my friend Michael. There was another Michael like me. And there was another friend called Chrisfield. We took over until those people left us the church. The church was theirs. We went there for prayers. They were praying quietly. This person prays and the other one take it. And the other one pray and the other one take it. We came and said, here no Holy Ghost. And we took over. We prayed and we jumped down the side and And you look later on, I look in life and I say it was all Ujan. A prayer that lack the reverence. Sometimes I must say this because it is you who are young people who are in those churches and who operate the instrument. Why do you need to pray with loudspeaker? Do you want the neighbors to hear? Why do you pray with the loudspeaker? For the village, the entire village to hear. So I went to a pastor friend and told him, why can't you remove this instrument when you people are praying? And you just pray. Because if it is preaching, I can understand. Maybe you want somebody outside to hear and be reached. But how about prayer? And so pastor did not hear. One day he told me this happened to him. A lady took microphone and he started praying and saying,
Oh Lord, this church is having problems. You know, all the market. Hii kanisa tuko na shida nyingi bwana. Oh na shida, kanisa inakwisha. So, pastor alikimbia akazima. He switched off the light. Dear friends, we need to come to God in prayer with reverence. Pour your heart before God. Do you know prayer is a war? Do you know you can watch your television free undisturbed? But when you want to pray, thoughts come from all corners and all matter of trials. Nevertheless, we must not give up. Instead of just talking, let us glorify the name of God by calling upon Him. He's invited us to come to Him in prayers. Let us go to God in prayer. And that will help us. Another way of fulfilling this commandment is by witnessing. It's by doing evangelism. You need to go and preach. Go and tell others about the goodness of our beloved Lord and Savior. You're not blaspheming His name. Witness about Him and His glorious love. How He saved you. How He grabbed you when you were dead in sins and trespasses. How He has made you alive. And tell them that He's the rock and the life that is willing to receive any who comes to Him. Free. You remember when you talk of those spiritual weapons, one of the weapons that we fight the enemy is taking the gospel of peace. It's taking the gospel of peace. And so we fulfill this commandment if the Lord give us ability, brethren, by witnessing. And then the last one, by keeping quiet. And that is all we will honor God. You don't need to be talking always. By keeping quiet. Because sometimes, you know, we can speak a bad about somebody. And by doing that, we are blaspheming the name of the Lord. Because a man is created in the image of God. And they bear God's image. And sometimes you need to be quiet. Just be quiet. That's not the proverb says that a fool, even a fool, when he's quiet, people think that he's a wise man. Yeah? Even a fool. When he's quiet, and people look at him, and say, he is a... Yeah. But they're even a madman. My dad was almost arrested because of his uncle, who was mad. You know, those days to take a person to Madeira, you have to take them to police and judge. They must be approved that they are not normal. And so his uncle had that problem. Taken to police, arrested. And when they stood in court, he was calm. And he won the case. He asked my dad, "Did I come to visit you here in Mombasa without seeking your permission?" And he said, "Yes." "That's why you are bringing me here now. You have brought me here simply because I came all the way from rural home to visit you. Without informing you." And the judge declared that my dad was wrong. He was almost put in. He only realized he was mad when he was released and took police bicycle. Then they said, "Oh, something is amiss." You know, sometimes, brethren, be quiet. Be quiet. That will honor, if that will honor the Lord Jesus Christ and honor God, be quiet, rather than blaspheming the Lord. Let me finish by saying this, to this commandment. If we call the name of God in vain, what will happen to us? Judgment is promised. For the Lord will not hold him guiltless that taketh his name in vain. So the people who call the name of God in vain, God will judge them. But the way judgment is future, but also judgment is present now. I don't have time to give you examples of people that blasphemed the name of God and were judged. You remember Goliath, who say, "I defy the God of Israel." What happened to him? He was killed. Was murdered. How about Herod? Not Herod. Pilate. No, Pilate was humble a bit. But there's another one who people praised that he spoke just like God. This was Herod. And he died instantly. And how about Pharaoh? He said, "Who is the Lord? His army is still chasing them." Remember, they died in the sea. And God rescued them. The children of Israel with the outstretched arm. God, our Father, will judge everyone who is calling his name in vain. Are you pretending that you are saved? You will not escape judgment. But there's a way out for you now. You can run to Christ Jesus for mercy and be forgiven. So that's the commandment which we are told. Thou shalt not call the name of the Lord your God in vain. I was doing sometimes back in our church, I've been doing the name studies on the names of God. And you see, even the passages which have been used, for example, when we say that Yahweh Shalom, you remember Gideon? At that particular time, they were restless. They were peaceless. The enemy encamped them and was finishing them. And God appeared to him. And when God appeared to him, he revealed himself, "I'm God of peace." So look at that. It's something that we not just chosen randomly. It is a carefully and in honor of the great name of God. Look at Yahweh, Rapha. No, Yahweh, Jehovah, Jireh. Yahweh, Jireh. Abraham is going to offer his son. And he asked, where is the sacrifice? And he said, "The Lord will provide for himself a sacrifice." And you remember when he was almost, the Lord provided a ram. And he said, "Oh, in the mountain of the Lord will provide." So it's not something just called randomly or vaguely. It's chosen carefully. Why are you not careful? I know that you did justification by faith alone when you did Galatians. And so I'm not telling anybody that this is the way you are saved. You cannot be saved if you try to keep this commandment, because you cannot keep it perfectly. You are saved by trusting upon the Lord Jesus Christ. Now that you trust in Christ Jesus, now that you have been made new, and now that the Holy Spirit lives in you, you are able now, given ability, not to call the name of God in vain. Let us come to him in prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, we come before you. ask you, Lord, to forgive us. Lord, sometimes even in our very preaching, we have called your name in vain. Sometimes, oh Lord, preachers have used preaching for their own benefit and not for your glory and for your own honor. Lord Jesus Christ, in many of our songs in our country today, there are songs that lack reverence to you, oh Lord. Your name is thrown anyhow, and there's no thought and respect and reverence and honor for your great name. Lord, even in our thoughts, sometimes we think things which we're not supposed to think about, O Savior. We pray that you forgive us. Wash us, O Father, with your precious blood. May the Holy Spirit work in us that we may be humble people. We may be people that have respect for our God. Lord, we live in the world today that respect is rare. But Father, we are praying that you may separate us, O Lord, from the world, that we may bow before you like the saints in heaven, like the angels who cannot look at you. They cover their eyes and with their wings ready to go and proclaim your word and ceaselessly cry, "Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty." Or like the saints who have gone before us who sang and say, "Worthy is the Lamb who was slain to receive both power, honor, and glory forever and ever." Oh Lord, may you help us to revere your name. Oh Savior, we still have remaining sin within us, but may you help us, oh Savior. And we long for that day when we shall come and totally rescue from the presence of sin itself. And Lord, we shall worship you as we ought to worship you, unhindered, oh Lord, with our limitation. But nevertheless, we thank you that you have redeemed us and you have transformed us. Now, Lord, we can bow before you. So help us, O Savior, and especially help the student here. We pray all these things in the name of the Lord Jesus. Amen.